So I would like to thank the scientific committee of this international forum. And today I'm going to present pregnancy with shunt lesions with or without pulmonary hypertension. And as you know, above 90% of children with congenital heart disease get into adulthood, and female patients get pregnant. And this is of high significance, since hemodynamic changes during pregnancy are huge, even for a woman without cardiac disease. And you can see here in the figure that cardiac output increases by 40 to 50%, initially because of the increase in the stroke volume, and afterwards because of the increase in the heart rate. And in parallel, we have also the systemic vascular resistance and the pulmonary vascular resistance that they decrease. And therefore, this can lead to a diagnosis of an unknown congenital heart disease or a complication of a non-congenital heart disease. And in our cohort, we found that 2 out of 3 of women weren't aware that they had congenital heart disease before their pregnancy. And indeed, now that I look back in our data, I found that this was mainly referred for patients with atrial septal defect. And if we see here the guidelines, the European guidelines for pregnancy, we can see that shunt lesions can be classified in 3 MHU, modified WHO categories. So successfully repaired simple lesions are considered modified WHO 1. Patients with an unoperated atrial or ventricular septal defect are in modified WHO 2, whereas patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension are in modified WHO 4. And this is very important because, as you can see, patients in modified WHO-1 and modified WHO-2 have a similar morbidity and mortality rate with a comparable morbidity and mortality rate with the general population, and they can be followed in local hospitals for a modified WHO-1 patients once or twice during pregnancy, and for modified WHO-2 at least once per trimester. In contrast, patients in modified WHO-4, they have a very high mortality and morbidity risk, and therefore pregnancy is contraindicated in this patient. And if pregnancy occurs, then termination should be discussed. And when we have a pregnancy in this patient, they should be followed in expert centers very often. And let's see why we have this heterogeneity in the literature. So, when Zahara investigators compared unrepaired ASD patients with controls, they found that these patients have a higher probability of presenting with preeclampsia or presenting neonatal complications such as small for gestational age babies and fetal mortality. Whereas when they compared repaired ASD versus controls, they didn't find a difference. And also, when they performed the univariable analysis, they found that neonatal complications were predicted by unrepaired ASD with an adjusted odds ratio 3. And when the same group checked on the VSD patients, they found that unrepaired VSD patients again had a higher probability of presenting with preeclampsia. And if we move now to pulmonary hypertension, you can see in this figure that normally we expect the vasodilation of the pulmonary vasculature. Whereas in patients with PH, this is not possible because of the pulmonary remodeling. And this causes a further increase in the afterload of the right ventricle. In parallel, we have the drop in the systemic vascular resistance. And this in Eisenmenger patients leads to an increase of the right to left shunt, and of the and so does the cyanosis. And the mechanisms are multiple. We can see here that right ventricle function is affected also by pain that causes sympathetic activation, by hypervolemia and volume shifts, by the direct effect of the gender hormones in the pulmonary vasculature, and etc. And even from 1998, we have the first systematic review that showed that maternal mortality was 36% in Eisenmenger patients. And then, because of the availability of the pulmonary arterial hypertension specific drugs, we wonder if the outcomes of pregnancy in these patients became better. And as we see here in the systematic review from 2009, we have a maternal mortality of 28%, and also the complications, the maternal complications and the neonatal complications were high. And another interesting finding of this study was that patients receiving general anesthesia were four times more likely to die compared with patients receiving regional anesthesia. And if we see the systematic reviews within time, here the mortality in CHD PAH patients dropped from 36% to 23%, but still was very high. And then we got the data from the ROPAC registry, which is a huge registry initiated from the European Society of Cardiology. And now I think they have more than 6,000 pregnant patients included. So here, from the paper for pulmonary hypertension and pregnancy outcomes, we see here in the red bars, the patients with congenital heart disease, pulmonary arterial hypertension, that the maternal mortality was less than 10%. However, the heart failure rate was more than 35%. And when the investigators compared patients with an RVSP above 70 with patients with an RVSP between 30 and 50 and between 50 and 70, they found that maternal mortality was mainly seen, only seen in the patients with a very high RVSP. Whereas heart failure was reported in all these groups, and there was no statistical significance among these three groups. And we also did an editorial that we saw that mortality was less than in the past, but still very high, and also the heart failure rate was very high. And now we have also the data from the 10 years of the ROPAC registry. Here we can see that in here for congenital heart disease, that the maternal mortality was low. The heart failure rate was a little bit higher, about 10%. Whereas here, for pulmonary arterial hypertension, the mortality rate was 9%, very high, and much higher was also the heart failure rate. And that was also beautifully depicted here in this figure, where you can see congenital heart disease to have a 6 or 7% of heart failure and/or mortality. Here in contrast, pulmonary arterial hypertension patients reported a 40% of heart failure and/or mortality. And it's very important if these patients decide to proceed in a pregnancy, to be followed from a pregnancy heart team, which must be consisted of a cardiologist, an obstetrician, and an anesthetist specialized in pregnancy and cardiac disease. And we know from the guidelines for pregnancy that patients with Eisenmenger syndrome have an indication 2A to deliver by cesarean section. And also we shouldn't forget the PAH specific drugs, that during pregnancy we can give the PDE5 inhibitors and prostanoids. And I would like to close this presentation with the cover page of the book of Professor Steer and Professor Gadzoulis for heart disease and pregnancy. That shows here the mother with cyanosis and clabbing just have given birth to a small baby. Many thanks.
Well, this was a great talk. Congratulations to Despoina. You showed us very well the change of the era. We're doing very well compared to 20 years or 30 years ago. You showed us, you explained us the reasons, the multidisciplinary teams, the better care of our patients. Of course, the drugs are doing a very good job in these patients. So, maybe, Michael, are we discussing now or are we continuing and having the discussion towards the end better?
If there are any burning questions, we can take a question now and then we'll have a group discussion at the end. I just wonder whether there is anybody who wants to ask something specific to Despoina. If we were to put this in a nutshell, I think just to make a brief comment here, just to emphasize what Despoina is telling us, pulmonary hypertension is very concerning and would not advocate women to become pregnant. But if they do, then as Despoina told us, the multidisciplinary environment with aggressive treatment for pulmonary hypertension, and in most cases, early delivery is the best way to have a good outcome. And outcomes, anecdotally, or there is some data, are much better now than what they used to be. I think we'll probably come back and discuss this very important topic. Well done, Despoina, excellent talk.